had to have learned English as a foreigner. And this would have put him into some kind of foreign relationship with God. And this was a devastating thought. And anyhow, this accounts for a certain feeling of supreme confidence, I suppose, in people who are born speaking English. And yet, there was for this child set in this country a very, very small minority, the governing class, surrounded by masses and masses of natives who died of all sorts of terrifying diseases all the time, which he himself, by which he himself was endangered, scorpions in the shoes and malaria, mosquitoes, terrible plagues, that very, very frightening. I mean, the world has changed. Well done. This, I'm sure all of you have had at some time in your childhood, if you flash back to it, the experience of repeating a word over and over and over again until suddenly all meaning is suddenly drained out of the sound. And it's a very frightening thing, this. Well, this happened to me in Ceylon, and this poem, the poem is about this, and it's about a bird called a coppersmith, which makes a noise in the tree. A temple tree grew in our garden in Ceylon. We knew it by no other name. The flower, if you turned it upside down, looked like a dagobah with an onion dome. A holy perfume, stronger than the evil tang of betel nut, enticed me into its shade on the stuffiest afternoon, where I stood and listened to the tiny hammer stroke of the crimson coppersmith perched above my head. His tuk, 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 and his donk, donk, donk was spoken in a language I never understood, and there I began to repeat out loud to myself an English word such as beat, 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 till hammering too hard I lost the meaning in the sound, which faded and left nothing behind, a blank mind. The compound spinning round, my brain melting, as if I'd stood in the sun too long without a topi and was going blind, till I and the bird, the word and the tree, were one. I'll read you one more poem about Ceylon before we return to Ireland. And this is called The Fall, and it happened, this, now we move now to up country, to Kandy, which was the old ancient capital of the Cingalese kingdom of Ceylon, where there's a famous temple of the tooth. And the poem is about scientific experiment and power and the fear of death. It's called The Fall, and of course that implies it's about sin. Thunder in the patterns, he's falling off a cliff. Every branch he catches breaks. Down he hurtles, counting. One, two, then wakes in the nick of time. His heart pounds with relief. It's Nanny's afternoon off. He untucks his mosquito net and shakes the fear of scorpions from his shoes. Hours to go, nothing to do but wait. A bell tolls at the temple of the tooth. He peeps at the bathroom coolie, rinsing a pot, picks up his cat, and saunters out to the upstairs nursery veranda. Would Marmalade die if he fell from this height? A bullock bandy creaks past the compound gate. Why don't you try it? His brother says. Cats have 4 feet to land on. They're not like us. He hugs the warm, purring bag of muscle, fur, and bone. Suppose it kills him. I dare you to do it. The boy holds his pet over the green balustrade and lets go. The legs fly out like an X, marmalade, pancakes, and lies dead still on the lawn. A wanderoo gibbers in the crown of a royal palm. Look, he's alive. I saw him twitch. They rush downstairs in time to see the cat vanish near a snake hole under a jasmine hedge. That night, he walks to the chair with long wooden arms. Whiskey glass, tobacco pouch, crossword puzzle, pen. To own up like a gentleman. Scent of cartridges ejected from a shotgun. Glint of pince-nez. Mosaic frown. The hand with a gold signet ring bends him down. A lion rampant on a little hairy finger. Out in the jungle, beyond the firefly net, pooches are biting marmalade, sucking his blood. Tuck up tight. I'm not going to kiss you tonight, naughty boy. Do all experiments go fat? Early in the morning, kitchen coolies shout. Marmalade walks in purring. 4 unbroken feet. Well, you don't have to go all the way to Ceylon to find cruelty or hunger or illiteracy. You can find it right at home in Ireland nowadays. You don't even have to go back to 1933. And the next group of poems, we're back in Ireland, the next group of poems is about the lives of people who live or have lived until very recently on the side of the roads, the travelling people of Ireland, or the tinkers, or the itinerants. They are the gypsies of Ireland, but I have to explain that they're not Romany gypsies. The Romanys, when they got as far as Ireland, one family came to Ireland and sent back word that there were far too many beggars on the road ahead of them. It wasn't worth their while coming in to the place. And so very few Romanys have infiltrated to Ireland. They just missed it out and came directly to America. And there has been a strong move by different people and by government and so on to educate the children of the travelling people. They tend to be, their economy is one of begging. The children are taught to beg when they're very young, so they don't have time to go to school. They can't go to school because they don't have any breakfast unless they go out to beg for it. And they get fed in the farmhouses. So they grow up illiterate. The tradition of the travellers in Ireland was nomadic. They have not been through the agrarian revolution that all settled people have been through in the past. They were living way, way back in the nomadic age. And this poem, is called The Reading Lesson, is an attempt to teach a 14-year-old boy of this background, who was born in a wattle tent in a ditch on the side of the road in Ireland, and who was taught by his mother to beg and steal when he was very young, and to teach him at the age of 14 how to read and write. And combined in my mind with that that theme was the thought that in the Greek mythology, that the protector of all travellers, the god of travel, was of course Hermes, who was also the god of commerce, and he was also the god of thieves. And you can see the connection, perfectly logical process. And he stole Apollo's cattle, and Apollo, the god of poetry, there was a certain friction between the poet and the itinerant. 14 years old, learning the alphabet, he finds letters harder to catch than hares without a greyhound. Can't I give him a dog to track them down? Or put them in a cage? He's caught in a trap until I let him go, pinioned by, "Don't you want to learn to read?" I'll be the same man whatever I do. He looks at a page as a mule balks at a gap from which a goat may hobble out and bleat. His eyes jink from a sentence like flush snipe escaping shot. A sharp word, and he'll mooch back to his piebald mare and bantam cock. Our purpose is as tricky to retrieve as mercury from a smashed thermometer. And he says, "I'll not read any more." Should I give up? His hands, long-fingered as a Celtic scribe's, will grow callous gathering sticks or scrap, exploring pockets, the horny drunk loiterers of the fairs giving them lice. A neighbor chuckles, "You can never tame the wild duck. When his wings grow, he'll fly off." If books resembled roads, he'd quickly read, but they're small farms to him, fenced by the page, plowed into lines with letters drilled like oats. A field of tasks he'll always be outside. If words were banknotes, he would filch a wad. If they were pheasants, they'd be in his pot for breakfast. Or if wrens, he'd make them king. When the children of travellers go to school, as they do now, when their parents are settled in houses by the county council, they come up against other problems in the learning process, other forms of cruelty, which may seem harsher to them than the natural cruelty of living a wild life on the side of the road. The next poem is called Shelter, and it's about a little girl who goes to a village school in the west of Ireland. And this is, technical note, this is a sonnet in two sentences without any rhyme. Girl with a sheaf of rye straw in your arms. How much you carry from a loaded trailer parked at the door in a stray sunny shaft at the tail end of summer, deep into the barn to store for thatch, if ever we get the weather or the time before winter sets in. How much you help me, child, in the hour after school, hour of your release, face wet with tears that well up out of a cruelty done to you, bruise marks around your lips, a speechless harm. How much you help me to make the dark inside glitter with sheaves bound firm to keep out storm. Hear how they rustle as we lay them down. Their broken heads are thrashed clean of grain. And the last in that sequence, so this is not to be thought of really as a sequence, it's just their poems on in the same area, is a more recent poem called Care, which you may have seen in the New York Review of Books recently. The poem I was pleased to see in that journal, which comes from printed in the West, published in the West Side of New York. You can't imagine anything further away, more remote in terms of sophistication and intelligence from an Irish goat. This poem is about an Irish goat, and it's in kind of terse rima. It's called Care, and in Ireland, Care as a word has been very much associated with the attempt to do something for underprivileged children in recent years, to put them into institutions and to wash them and clothe them and so on. And this poem is on that very, very theme of what happens when you try to t- take a creature from the wild and do everything in the world for it. Kidded in April, above Glen Columkill, on a treeless hill backing north, she throve, sucking milk off heather and rock, until I came with children to buy her. We drove south, passing Drumcliff. Restless in the car, bleating, she gulped at plastic tits we'd shove copiously in her mouth. Soon she'd devour whatever we'd give. Prettily, she poked her gypsy head with horn buds through barbed wire to nip off peatops, her fawn pelt streaked with black forest shadow and alpine snow. I stalled her wildness in a pen that locked. She grew tame and fat, fed on herbs I knew her body needed. We ransacked Kylemore to bring her oak leaf, ivy and bark to chew. I gutted goat books, learning how to cure fluke, pulpy kidney, black gargit, looping ill. All my attention bled to cope with her. No fenceless commonage to roam, no hill transfigured into cloud, no dragon wood to forage with a puck-led flock, but the rattle of a bucket, shouts of children bringing food across a frozen yard. Out in a forest, she would have known a bad leaf from a good. Here, captive to our taste, she'd learnt to trust the petting hand with crushed oats, or a new mash of concentrates, or sweet bits of waste. So, when a child mistook a sprig of yew and mixed it with her fodder, she descried no danger. We had tamed her instinct, too. Whiskey, white of egg, linseed oil. We tried forcing down antidotes. Nothing would do. The children came to tell me when she died. From that sad, low subject, I want to move now finally to a sequence of poems that are set, at least, on a more sublime location. And this is an island off the west coast of Ireland, a great lump of rock that juts up out of the sea very, very abruptly, called High Island, and it's totally uninhabited today. It was only occupied with any continuity in the golden age of saints and scholars. A hermitage was founded on High Island in the 7th century by Saint Fehin, and it lasted on and off until 1018, the 5th of August, 1018, when Saint Gorhamgol died there. He was the last of the saints to have his name entered in the Irish martyrologies. You may say the last Irish saint. He was a spiritual advisor of Brian Boru, the High King of Ireland, who was killed at the Battle of Clontarf on Good Friday, 1014, by a Viking, by a Dane. And at that very moment, the Battle of Clontarf was fought 200 miles away from High Island on the eastern, near Dublin, east coast of Ireland. High Island is off the west coast. At that very moment, on that Good Friday, St. Gorhamgol sent one of his monks to the well on High Island for some water, and he came back with a bucket of blood, thus indicating to the good man that the High King was dead, and that the water in the well on High Island has remained bloody until 1969, when I became the lucky possessor and guardian of the island. And then I found that it had turned into a black, stinking slime. And when I reported this to a fisherman, an old fisherman on the island of Inishbofin, he immediately said, That must be on account of the trouble in the north of Ireland. And I've made it my one of my duties to keep the well in the water in that well on High Island as pure as possible. The island is, I think, the most beautiful thing on the island. It has many, many aspects. And the thing that I go back for, as I will be going back there very soon, is the storm petrel. And the storm petrels have chosen High Island as one of their nesting grounds. The storm petrel is the smallest of the birds that spends its entire life at sea. It's a pelagic ocean bird. And it's about the size of a swallow, about that sort of size. And colonies of them nest on High Island. They come in from the ocean in the spring, and they particularly like the ruins of the Christian hermitage as a place to lay their eggs underground in the graves of the hermits, under the altar, in the walls of the oratory. And the birds hatching on the nest, when they start to send out a signal to the birds in the sky, do sound like the resurrection. The whole ground under your feet starts to vibrate at nightfall. They particularly call, the birds that are sitting on the nest call out, start to call at dusk, and they keep up their messages until dawn to the birds that are flying in from the ocean to join them. Now, the reason for this is that the storm petrel has had a very good custom of sharing the labor of hatching the egg and rearing the young bird equally between the sexes. And it's been practicing this fact of equal rights for 60 million years, according to the fossil record, so that even if it takes the Senate and the states a little bit longer, they'll get around to it, and when they do get around to it, it will be forever. And the bird on the nest is sending a signal to the bird in the sky so that it can identify its nest, locate it, and so they can change places, the male and the female. And it's a very beautiful, strange sound in a totally foreign language. And I tried to find English words that would fit what seemed to me to be what the storm petrels were saying. And I wrote a poem called Nocturne about the sounds of the storm petrel at night on High Island. The blade of a knife is tapped gently on an oak table. Waves are sobbing in coves. Light bleeds on the sky's rim from dusk till dawn. Petrels fly in from the ocean. Wings beating on stone. Quick vibration of notes, throats, tongues under silver weed. Calling and calling. Louder cries cut the air. They rise from a pit. Complaints are wrenched up and lost. A solo tune is dying with passion for someone out there to come quickly. Come back, come back. I'm here, here, here. This burrow, this wall, this hole. Ah, who kept you? Where have you been? There, there, there. It's all over, over. Over. There's a big lump of granite on the island near the monastery, and it has no figures carved on it. It's very smooth and slippy, very, very heavy to lift. It must weigh 120-130 pounds, and it's almost round. And I address these words. Everybody who goes to the island wonders what it is, and they try to lift it, and it's almost impossible. I address these words to the granite globe on High Island. Straining my back seven times, I've lifted you up to my thighs. There are men who've put you sitting high on their shoulders. It looks as if you'd been lopped off the top of a column, then used as a quern, kicked around, buried. An archaeologist taped you and wrote you down. He said, "You're an oblate spheroid." Does it matter? Whoever carved you gave you all the time in the world. Well, that word time reminds me that it's time to close. And I'll read you, finally, a poem about the grey Atlantic seals, which have quite a large colony on High Island, a colony that's threatened both by Atlantic storms and also by the fishermen who sometimes shoot the seals, because the seals like to pick the fish out of the salmon nets, and they tear the nets when they do this, so that the fishermen hate seals. And I heard them sing once, and the melody haunted me for 3 or 4 years until I wrote this poem. They are like the sirens in the Odyssey, or like the banshee in Irish mythology, like mermaids singing. Very, very beautiful, very, very plaintive melody that combines the passion of a slow movement of one of Beethoven's late quartets with the most ultra-modern atonal electronic music written on a synthesizer. And this poem is a celebration of a poem about the seals, who in September, the harvest period, give birth to their young in the coves, and then 2 weeks later they mate. So the whole process of generation is happening at the one time in the colony and on the island. The seals at High Island. The calamity of seals begins with jaws. Born in caverns that reverberate with endless malice of the sea's tongue clacking on shingle, they learn to bark back in fear and sadness and celebration. The ocean's mouth opens 40 feet wide and closes on a morsel of their rock. Swayed by the thrust and backfall of the tide, a dappled gray bull and a brindled cow copulate in the green water of a cove. I watch from a cliff top, trying not to move. Sometimes they sink and merge into black shoals, then rise for air, his muzzle on her neck, their winged feet intertwined as a fish tail. She opens her fierce mouth like a scarlet flower full of white seeds. She holds it open long at the sunburst in the music of their loving and cries a little. But I must remember how far their feelings are from mine marooned. If there are tears at this holy ceremony, theirs are caused by brine and mine by breeze. When the great bull withdraws his rod, it glows like a carnelian candle set in jade. The cow ripples ashore to feed her calf, while an old rival, eyeing the deed with hate, swims to attack the tired triumphant god. They rear their heads above the boiling surf, their terrible jaws open, jetting blood. At nightfall, they haul out and mourn the drowned, playing to the sea sadly their last quartet, an improvised requiem that ravishes reason while ripping scale up like a net, brings pity trembling down the rocky spine of headlands, till the bitter ocean's tongue swells in their cove and smothers their sweet song.